In the past videos, we signed up for a Ticketor website. We designed it and we integrated our payment processing method. So our website is now essentially ready. We can create an event and start selling tickets immediately. Obviously, there are many more things you can do with your website. For example, you can add pages here, you can edit the content, you can integrate with Facebook, Google, and more, but they are all optional and you can skip them for now and add them whenever you have time. So let's look at the notification box and see what's the next step. The next step is to add an event. As you can see, I have to go to Administrative, Events, Events to add an event. So let's look at it here. Administrative, Events, Events. Or alternatively, there's an Add Event button here on the Tickets page, which is a shortcut to the same functionality. Let's click on the Add Event button and start adding an event. This is the event information page. As you can see, there is an information tab, delivery tab, return policy, pictures, tickets, and promote. Let's start with the information tab. We should fill out the event name. There is an optional secondary name that goes on the second line, and you can use that if your event name is too long. We have to select the promoter. The promoter is the person who owns the event. He or she will get an email on every sale, and then they'll have access to the sales reports for the event. If there's somebody besides you, the administrator, who needs to have access to this data, you need to introduce them as a promoter and choose them as the event promoter. By default, you are the only promoter in the system. Next is the event date and time. I'm going to pick a date, Saturday, and then the time, I'm going to put 9 p.m. The sales start date is the exact date and time when you want to start the ticket sales. Before this time, the event will be listed on your upcoming events page with an information button, but no tickets button. At the sales start date, the information button will change to the tickets button and sales will start. Unless you want to hold the ticket sales up to a certain time, you can choose today or any date in the past and start the sales immediately. The next field is the sale end date and time. Similarly, at this time, the ticket sales will end and the tickets button changes back to the information button. Please note that the sale end date can actually be after the event date, as you may want to continue your sales even after the event starts. In this example, the event starts at 9 p.m. and ends at 12 a.m. We're going to leave the sales open until 11, which is 2 hours after the start of the event. The gate control system will be able to validate tickets as they sell, and there is absolutely no issue with validating the tickets that are sold later. The next field is the venue. If you have already created the venue or the venue is already in the system, you should be able to find it by just typing in a couple of letters. So let's say I want to use the Nokia Theater. As I type a few letters, it shows up. I can simply select this, and if my venue doesn't exist in the system, I can just click on Create a New Venue button. I have to enter the venue's name, so I'm going to put in Demo Venue. The seating chart name is optional. I'm not going to use that now. The region, I'm going to put in Los Angeles, California, and I should fill in the address. Make sure to put in the address accurately as it will show up on the website, and Ticketon users can get a map and direction base on it. 123 Main Street, Santa Monica, California. Choose the venue's country. Here's a list of all the countries. Obviously, I select the United States. Specify the time zone. All the times, including the start and end dates based on the venue's time zone. Time zone here is Pacific, United States, and Canada. And then I hit save. And the record has been updated successfully. My venue is now created, and here I see an open seating chart designer button. If I'm planning to have an assigned seat event, I have to use this seating chart designer tool to design my seating chart. Now, I'm not going to design a seating chart in this video as there is another video on this subject, but for the purpose of this video, I will create a general admission event, and for that, I don't need a seating chart. Okay, let's close this venue information pop-up. My new demo venue is now in the venue field. The currency for this event is US dollars. Now, we support many currencies. You may choose the euro, the Canadian dollar, the Australian dollar, the pound from Great Britain, so on and so forth. So you have categories here. Let's say party. It's an optional field. There are two options for the seating type, and it's very important to set it correctly. It could be general admission, or in other terms, first come, first serve, or it could be assigned seats. A general admission event is the type of event that the seats do not get assigned during the ticket purchase, and as a result, there's no seat number on the tickets. All standing events and first-come, first-seat events fall into this category. However, there may be different sections and different pricing levels. The other type of events are called assigned seat events. In an assigned seat event, seat numbers are assigned during the ticket purchase and tickets have seat numbers printed on them. In an amphitheater-style venue, the seat position is usually identified by three parameters: the section, the row number, and the seat number. In a roundtable venue, the seat location is identified by table name and seat number. So I'm going to select General Admission. There's an active checkbox here. If it's checked, the events will be active and visible to users on the upcoming events page. The next field is a big description box. It is a rich text editor, and I can add any details about the event here. I can also add videos and additional pictures. Now, the user will see all this information on the event information page. I'm going to put a short note here, 21 years old and over. I can also put something like doors open at 8 p.m. Using this toolbar, I can change the font, the size, and the style of the text. So let's make it bigger to stand out. Make it red, bold, italic, and set the alignment to center. As you can see in the toolbar, there's a button for embedding an image and another button for embedding a video. If you're a professional web designer and want to edit the source HTML, you can click on Edit Source and update the HTML. The next tab are the delivery methods. Now, there's basically three different delivery methods. The most popular delivery method is e-tickets. If you offer this method and the user selects it, they can easily print their e-tickets at home and get admitted using the printed tickets. It's really the best option for the users as they receive their tickets immediately and they don't have to wait in line to pick it up. It is the best option for you because, well, it requires no effort on your side. Another delivery method is called will call, which means the buyer will purchase the ticket and pay for it online, but they'll pick them up later on. Usually the pickup location is a booth at the venue, but it could also be some retail store or another designated location. People who don't have access to a printer will choose this option. And the third delivery method is mail. The buyer purchases the ticket, they pay the amount online, and then you print out the tickets and then we'll mail them to the buyer. Unlike the first two methods, there is some cost involved in mail delivery. By default, the system comes with the first two delivery methods. You can add as many delivery methods as you need, and you can associate shipping charges with delivery methods that the user will pay as part of the purchase. You can click on this Add Delivery Method button and define new delivery methods. For this specific event, I'm going to stick with the default methods, will call and print e-tickets, and I'll check both to offer both options. The next tab is the return policy. By default, the return policy is to not accept returns and that all sales are final. If you want to accept returns, you can click on Return Accepted, then you can specify until what time you'll accept returns. The default value is 48 hours before the event. You can also specify a deduction percentage. The deduction percentage will be deducted from the return amount. For example, I can say I want to deduct 10% if the tickets are returned for store credit. Store credit credited to the user balance, and the user can use it towards further purchases. If the user or you want to exchange the tickets for another set of tickets, you can simply return the tickets for store credit or the account balance and use the credit to go buy another set of tickets. And I'm going to charge 15% if they want to get a refund to their credit card or their PayPal account. The system will automatically enforce this return policy, and if a return is allowed, the user can simply log into their account and return their tickets. The next tab are the pictures. Now, pictures are optional, but it is highly recommended that you upload at least one image or flyer. We support flyers, thumbnail, and pictures of the venue, which can be an image of the seating plan. I'm going to click on Browse, choose this as my flyer, and I'm going to check this checkbox that reads Use This as Thumbnail. So it will resize it and use it as both my flyer and thumbnail. And I'm going to hit Save. The event has been created successfully. Great! So if I browse to the Tickets or Upcoming Events page in a new tab, I should see the event there. The event is here. Here's the date, here's the thumbnail, here's the address and direction, and here's the Buy Tickets button. Now if I click on the image, I can get more information including the text we entered at the description box. See, 21 and over. Also, it indicates what time the ticket sales will end, and it clearly describes my return policy. I can click on the tickets button to purchase tickets, but as you can see, there are no tickets for this event here as we haven't added any tickets yet. The message box reads, "Sorry, no tickets available for this event." And since we're logged in as the administrator, it gives me the option to add tickets. Please note that if you don't see this ticket button or you see an info button instead, it means that either the ticket sales have not started yet or they've already ended. You may need to edit the event and check your sales start date and sales end time. I'm going to edit this event and I'm going to set the sales start date to tomorrow and show you how it looks. I can go to the upcoming events page and click on edit, or I can go to administrative menu, events, events, and click on the edit button for the event. I change the sales start date to 12 a.m. tonight. I hit save and go back to the home page. And as you can see, the tickets button is now replaced with the information button. The user can get information, but they can't buy tickets until the start time and date. So let's change it back. Edit event again. And change the start date to today, so tickets will be available immediately. The next tab in the event info page is the tickets tab. There's a couple of options here, like if you want to show the remaining numbers of tickets that are available to the user, or if you want to show the service charge. And there's an Add Update Tickets button that takes me to the ticket editing page. There's a couple alternative ways to get to the ticket editing page. One is from the table below. It lists all the events, and I can simply click on the tickets link in my events row. The other option, or the easiest to reach, is on your upcoming events page. Now, if I click on the tickets in the top nav, I can click on the Add Update Tickets here, which takes me to the exact same page. This is how the ticket editing page looks for general admission events. Now please note that it looks totally different for assigned seat events. Basically, in a general admission event, I can have different sections, and I can have different price levels for each section. Let's see what each section actually means. I click on Add Section. Sections could be different areas in your venue where each area requires a different ticket type. You may have a main floor, balcony, different types of tickets, probably at different prices for each section. You may have standing tickets and seated tickets. You can have general admission tickets or VIP tickets. So for this demo, let's have a section for the main floor. And you can put in a short description here, for example, standing tickets. Then you have to set the ticket price for this section. The ticket price will consist of three prices. Now first is the ticket face value price, which is the value printed on the ticket. Then there is the service charge, which is the dollar amount or percentage of the face price that you want to charge as service fees. And last, we have the buy price. Now, buy price only makes sense if you are a reseller and buy the tickets at a discounted rate for resale. The buy price could be the dollar value or a percentage of the face value price. You can put in 95% if you get 5% discount on your purchase, or you could put in 28% if you buy the tickets for $28. So since I'm promoting my own event, I'm going to put 0 as I'm not buying the tickets. I'm going to specify a face price, and so let's say for the main floor, our face price is going to be $40, and then the service charge. As you know, there is some cost and fees involved in selling tickets. Now, there's a small fee for Ticketor and a fee for your credit card processor, and your charges usually come around 5 to 6%. So you could set the service fees to 6% to cover all your charges. You could put 0 or a lower amount if you don't want to charge for any service fees and pay the fees from your pocket, or you could put some higher percentage and earn extra income from ticketing. Most ticketing websites do charge 10 to 25% in service charges, so if you do charge 10%, you're actually making 4% extra on each ticket. So I'm going to put 10% here, and I'm going to add this section. So far, we defined a section, and we defined the general price for the section. You can have different price levels for each section as well. So let's say for the main floor, I want to have a discounted price level for students or senior citizens. So I'm going to add this price level. In the description, I will write, "You must present a valid student ID to get admitted." And the face price for this ticket is $30. So there's a $10 discount comparing to the general price. And I'm going to charge 10% or $3 per ticket. Next, I will add tickets for this section. For example, the capacity of the main floor is 100 people, so I will then add 100 tickets for this section. Here is an add or delete option that I can use to add or delete tickets. I select add, put in 100 in the box, and click on the add tickets button. 100 tickets added successfully. Now the system makes sure not to sell over 100 tickets for this section, but out of this 100, some will be sold at general price and some at the student price. My venue also has a balcony section, so I'm going to add a new section, balcony. No description here. The balcony tickets are $20, and again, a 10% service charge. So I'm going to add this section. And the balcony can accommodate 50 people, so I'm going to add 50 tickets for the balcony. You can also specify different price levels for the balcony. I'm going to add a VIP price level to my main floor. I select the main floor, click on Add Price Level. The name is VIP. Description is includes unlimited drinks. And the price is $70 with a 10% service charge. And hit Save. Now to give you a better idea, I'm also going to add an early bird discounted price level for the main floor. So in other words, if you buy early, you can buy at a discounted rate. Add price level. Name is early bird in description. I will put available until some date. Face price $35 with 10% in service charge fees. And down here, I want this price level to become available as soon as my tickets go on sale. And I want this to go away at a certain date and time, next Saturday. And save this price level. Down here is a table that shows the number of tickets in each section. We can check it out to verify our settings. Again, the main floor has 100 tickets. They're all available. Zero expired. Zero sold. Balcony, 50 tickets. Zero expired. Zero sold. The total, 150 tickets. So everything looks good. Okay, let's go to the user side and see how it looks to the user and how they can choose their section and price level. Let's go to the tickets page. And I can click on the tickets button. Here is the find tickets page exactly as what your users see. The user can see that there is a main floor for $40, VIP, early bird, students, and balcony for $20. I'm going to add two main floor tickets, and I'm going to add one main floor student ticket, and here at the top is my shopping cart with all three tickets. It is not showing me the service charge at this point, as we set that in the event settings, so my total so far is 80 plus 30, it's $110. So I can click on proceed to checkout here, and go to the checkout or payment page. Or if I'm on any other pages, I can hover over my shopping cart up here and I can click on checkout. On the checkout page, I should first choose a delivery method. The delivery methods we set in the event setup showing here. So I can either choose will call or the e-ticket option. So let's choose e-tickets. As you can see, the price is $110. There is a non-refundable service charge of 10% or $11, so the total is $121. If you offer a promotion code and the buyer has one, they can put that here and hit apply to get the discount. Next, they can specify their payment method. As we have integrated both a merchant account and PayPal, both options are available to the user here. If they choose credit card, they can fill out the billing and credit card information and finalize the sales here. If they choose PayPal, they get this PayPal button, which will then take them to PayPal to make the payment and finalize the sales.